Frank Sheehan and David Watts, who have an interesting approach to AVIT, ergonomics, interior design. There seems to be so much in there, doesn't there, Frank? But it's a really good presentation, this, so I'll hand over to you. Very similar to the last one, but it's an interesting approach. A lot more elements involved, haven't
you? Sorry, I was sent to the back of the class as usual.
I know.
I'm Frank Sheehan. Some of you know me, probably wish they didn't, and there's other people here that don't know me. So what happened here we go. Technology works, that's scary. So, I've been in the industry for more years than I can shake a stick at, really. I was asked by Clive and Rob to do a discussion about a project that David and I worked on in the Middle East. So technology, interior design and sand don't always go well together. They asked to discuss a case study. There's some things around the project which we can't actually talk about, which is the name of the project, because there's tenders and things coming out for those. So, and actual technology specific things, but we can talk about how we can come together to work to try and figure out solve a problem. So kind of a quick kind of agenda. As you can see, there's pretty much a similarity between the physical space and the interior design and the technology, bringing the two together. What's quite interesting is listening to Gary's presentation was there are so many similarities and parallels to exactly what we had with this, which is commonality, user-friendly, all the things that making the life simple. Because the space they've got at the moment, which I have to admit I was involved with designing back in 2006, and now it comes for a technology refresh, was that the technology that they required to create this collaborative learning environment just wasn't really there. We came up with various different ideas, and we created a network to provide scalability. But of course, what's happened is technology has just zoomed off so quick that it wasn't able to keep up with the change. So now they ended up getting a real kind of dysfunctional kind of load of a kit. They got these touch panels which were really complicated, difficult to use. They'd have instructors that were coming in, because it's an oil and gas company, training their young engineers. One of the things that was quite interesting was that a lot of the guys, they come in to do training, they're in their 60s and 70s and technophobes. And so coming up and having these displays which put multi-source viewing and all cool things like that up on there, it's just like, where do I plug this in? So you've given them a thumb, they come and turn up with their USB drive. I thought with this American thing, I said thumb drive for a moment. But they come up with a USB stick, plug it in, they just want to do PowerPoint and death by PowerPoint, and they want their flip charts. So what you ended up with was these spaces look like. So you've got these really fixed furniture. It's supposed to be collaborative. And it needed to be, trained. The training in there was just impossible to do anything kind of collaborative. The idea was to provide a various different group of individuals in the oil and gas industry in the upstream side of the business. So the upstream side of the business for any oil and gas company is where the money is. That's where they do all the seismic stuff, where they do all the surveys and everything else to do with the oil and gas and getting it out of the ground and processing it. So training, having what happens with historically with the oil and gas industry is the engineers have all been in their silos and they sit there and they're not interested in, a problem comes up. How do you get them together and collaborate and start resolve problems? How do you get people together and resolve these issues? So this is kind of, again, leading to what Gary was talking about, is about bringing people together and these very easy to use spaces where it just things you just plug and play and get rid of all these horrible kind of spaces where you've got computers all under the desks and everything else, and it's just horrendous spaces, and they're quite dark and depressing. And then you've got this audio thing up there, which is these battery-operated things, which basically they're never used, and they just get tossed to one side, and radio mics and so forth. So what ended up happening was that it was a design brief was put together after I was contracted originally just to do the technology side of thing, and having done an initial bit of consulting work back in 2013, 14, when I said your spaces themselves don't work, let alone the technology, they decided to throw me interior design into my mix, which I don't do. So having that to deal with was a challenge. So I asked David to come and help out on that. So between the two of us, we had to go through a particular brief with the client. And this is kind of really pretty much it. So it's about flexible, scalable, all those kind of things, things that Gary was talking about, onto the high quality audio. Well, one of the interesting challenges was, as we just had earlier on, just now, was there's me all mic'd up. And these were these oil and gas guys. Well, some of them didn't want to wear them because they're old guys, and they just said, I don't want all that crap hanging on around my neck. And then another situation would be where if they're trying to do something collaborative in the space, was just like now, I was standing at the back, so I could hear Gary speak nice and clear, and someone there asked a question. But they couldn't, you couldn't really hear from the back properly what was being said. So how do you have a microphone you carry around, or do you wire everybody up? So the idea was to have this kind of way of being able to pick up sound as if by magic. So you have this kind of like air, wherever you were in the room, you could pick up someone and be heard clearly. Another thing which was quite interesting was is that they have a scenario, they have part of their training program where they have a room, in this room where you've got the instructor who's wired up with a microphone, and you've got the students, and they reenact the Gulf disaster. And so what the idea was that the guy who was up in the fourth floor in the office, he would play the guy who's the rig manager. And he would say, oh, we've got all these problems, this is why. And they would have to work together to work with the guy who's the rig manager. But the trouble is, the instructor is standing there. You can hear what he's being said, what he's saying, sorry. And it's all being recorded. But you couldn't hear what the students were saying. So what happened was that the instructor would have to kind of very carefully, oh, you said this, blah, 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 did you? Oh, right, okay. So it was just really cockeyed. So they wanted to go up for all these things. It was just so much about it, the spaces, it just didn't work. So that's it. So I'll quickly go through this because everybody knows I talk too much. So I tried to let David have a chance to speak. So this is a company. This is my little empire, or our little empire, if you like, of what we do. So I come from a very specialized, high large-scale visualization kind of environment. But when I started the company, what was very apparent to me was that, okay, I come from an AV background-ish. I've delved into the IT space because of the big visualization stuff I've done, and high-performance computing and graphics. But I had to bring in someone who works as my co-director, who's actually, he's an IT guy. He comes from that world. He understands it fully. He's a bit shady on the AV side, but that's okay. But we've got a bit of an overlap. So we've got this, we were able to then be able to cover the whole aspect of everything regarding this particular project. Because this wasn't just an AV project. Because they had all these computers in these rooms, which they wanted to get out and change all the furniture. So from our perspective, so what we ended up doing, we had to remove all these PC workstations. It was in excess of 500, and there were some laptops as well. So your solution was to do VDI. And the other thing also they wanted to do was to put everything, so all the machines, all back of house, all out of the way, clear floors, just plug in. You just turn up, so you've got a rack up, rod pack up, plug in your video, your monitors, keyboard and mouse, one twisty pair, job done, thank you very much. And that's your classroom sorted out for all the different desks. Very, very simple. Greatly improved the experience for the oral experience. Important for event simulation, which you just heard me speak about. So everything, so all the microphones are all taken up out of everybody's way. They're all up in the ceiling space, or it's like as if by magic, things just happen. And same with the network. Everything is networked around the building. So wherever you're going to go, in real time, you would hear something going on in any particular space. That was something else they wanted. They wanted to go to higher resolution. But as you saw, one of the other slides was that you've got these projectors, just like here, hanging down, noisy, become noisy, so interfering with the instructors, people not hearing things properly, crap imaging, lousy contrast, you name it, the list is as long as your arm. So what they wanted to do was, right, we're going to go for flat panel displays. So you think 4K? So you put a 4K panel up here. Do you think anybody here is going to be able to read what's on the damn thing? Well, no, not without a little bit of jiggery and pokery in the settings. But the idea was there's going to be panels everywhere. So we put these panels around everywhere. So the idea is you just push it out to everywhere, and everybody's working together. So hey-ho, away we go. And the other thing also was about distributing 4K. How the hell do you do it? Well, we started seeing this plethora of devices that are coming out in the market now that enables you to put 4K, various interesting kind of combinations of how you're going to do that. But anyway, the fact of the matter is it's all becoming very obviously network-centric, which has been a world that I've been working on for 15 to 20 years now with other stuff that I used to do right back in the days with, interesting, with, like Gary was talking about, Google. The people that present office and had the offices in Mountain View beforehand, SGI, Stick and Graphics, is someone that used to work a lot with back in them days. So we came, so everything was on the network, whether it was audio, it was PoE, and of course, USB. Why would you have USB? Touch screens, something that Gary was talking about. So technology-wise, building network is all on the backbone. So we had to work with sort out the network thing. I'm not a network guy. I know a little bit, enough to make, I've got a little bit of knowledge to be dangerous. But when you're working in this kind of organization, you cannot do that. Hence, my colleague Lee. He comes in, and he's able to communicate with these guys because we would. There was a presentation that David and I had to do. I had the morning slot, David had the afternoon slot. And there was, I don't know how many people there, David, there was a lot of guys there. And they were there were the network guys, the storage guys, there was AV guys, there was a whole bunch of people, and facilities people for the interior design. All sorts of questions. So my hour and a half, 2 hour slot, I broke a record of mine, personal record of mine, for a presentation that lasted in excess of 6 hours, I seem to remember, David. Quite remarkable. 6 hours, because there was all these questions and asking, and it was quite random, the questions that were coming back about what was the design intent of what we came about after our initial brief. So David had to do his the next day, and I think he did yours about half an hour, I think, in the end, or something like, because they weren't particularly interested. There was no disrespect to you. Sorry. That's what happens when you do cushions and fluffy clungs. But anyway... A bit disrespectful, isn't it? So it was a little bit of banter we have going. So having, we managed to convince them that they had to go 10 gig, obviously. Now they got what we're doing is the way it's structured, and don't ask me how it's structured. Because if I told you, I'd probably have to take you out and shoot you, because that's because of the rules of engagement I have with them. But the fact of the matter is, I just don't know because it's not my expertise, and Lee was the one that sorted it out with them. But the fact of the matter is, we managed to upgrade the current infrastructure and do some things in a very creative way, which they're quite happy about in several ways. One is because we're going to get squeezed more out of their system. It was quite funny, actually, with some of it. But there also is that we're saving them money. Oil and gas people are very, very conscious of money at the moment because the oil and gas price is pretty crap. And in the Middle East, they're struggling a little bit because that's most of their revenue, and they don't earn much money out of dates or anything else. So, seems oil and gas is the thing that they're going to make money out of. I like dates, but I don't eat that many of them. That's kind of it. So this is where we kind of got to with the technology. And now I hand over to my esteemed colleague, and I'll shut up because I don't want you going on for 6 hours. Can you get? We'll be ordering breakfast.
It was great fun. I enjoyed every minute of it. Thank you very much. Just very quickly, by way of introduction, just about who I am. So I run a company called CCD. We're a design practice, but we're based very much around understanding human behavior. So as designers, we're not really about trying to do really loads of cool stuff just for the sake of it. We really want to understand how people use spaces, products, services, and design around that. We've been doing it a while now, and it's just it's lots of different disciplines coming together in an organization to design stuff. So this was a really interesting project for us because our perspective is always about trying to understand how people sit between technology, the space they're in, and what they're trying to achieve. And surprisingly, being in that space when we're doing interiors and workspaces, the technology stuff is quite often somewhere distant, and we don't get to work sort of hand in hand like we did on this project. So it was a really, I thought it was a really great experience. And also, I mean, I suppose referring back to what Gary was talking, it was an interesting journey for a client, understanding that creating a different environment, looking at new ways to get people to collaborate, different ways to get people to learn in this environment, required much more than technology and required really how they changed and rethought the space and how the space was used, and how we integrated that together. So the journey they were on was going from this situation where you had the classrooms, as Frank showed earlier, which were very much like, you know, we might remember from school, all sitting in rows, sitting silently while the lecturer sits at the front, probably buried behind a load of screens so you can't even see him, and he just takes you through a load of stuff. And they wanted to make this much more collaborative environment where you got the instructor out from behind their desk, got them engaged, got them people working in groups, and different ways in which they could teach the material and the participants could learn together. And that meant we had to think about flexibility, we had to think about a whole series of different ways in which we could enable that alongside the technology. So just a few things that we went through with them to try and look at that. One was this concept around how we might reconfigure spaces. They had to be able to adapt to different kind of lectures, different kind of material that was going through. So how do we think about creating spaces that aren't just stuck, fixed with the infrastructure, as Frank was saying earlier, stuck with fixed furniture, and that we can produce something that's much more flexible and adaptable. We wanted something that people, you know, Frank alluded to, particularly around the lecturers. We wanted people that we could just come in, we could start the class, we weren't messing around trying to get the technology to work. We were ignoring people who came in with their overhead projector and wanted to put out, you know, old technology, but we didn't want the technology to get in the way. So that all of that concept was really important. We wanted the students to be engaged in the sessions, so we wanted them to be able to contribute. As Frank pointed out, in terms of how that worked in terms of audio, that was just one part of it. So how do we get people to be able to contribute with remote locations as well, and enable that both in the space and with the technology? We wanted to think about different ways in which people would collaborate and different ways in which the students would work. So there would be time and space for working on their own, working in small groups, working in larger groups. And that was important to think about how we enabled that and how we created different spaces in which that could be achieved. And we also wanted to create a sort of vibrancy to the place. As the images Frank showed earlier, you'll see it was a pretty bland, vanilla kind of space. And we wanted something that really engaged the people coming into this environment with the organization that they were working for. So we had a few themes running through some of our exploration. So these are just a few of them. So one was this thinking differently about collaboration. So how could we use technology and furniture to bring people through together in groups, to be able to share content, to be able to engage in different kind of discussions in a learning environment. So that was one of the themes that we wanted to explore with the client. We wanted to look at this adaptive furniture concept. How could we set up on one day for a particular kind of class and then very quickly in the afternoon reconfigure the room, change the furniture, change the technology, and be able to run a very different kind of class in the afternoon. So all of that kind of repurposing in different kinds of spaces, because we're also dealing with some space constraints. It's not a new building. We're dealing with the existing building, so we have some constraints around the kind of different spaces we can use. And then the final theme that I just wanted to touch on, nice having had Gary talk about it, was about serendipity. How do we get people to not just come in, sit in their classroom for 2 or 3 hours, and then just sort of disappear out and not talk to each other? So how could we think about different spaces in the environment that would bring people together from different courses? we won't see very much of it in this presentation, but we did a whole piece of work looking at how we used lobby spaces, how we use social spaces to be able to bring some of the students to get together and spend more time with each other and try and engage with each other in different ways and how we could do that with different kinds of furniture. So those were three of the main themes that we ran through. We had a quite long design process with them, which was interesting. I'll come back to you later, talking about how we ran this in parallel with Frank's technology. So we explored all sorts of different designs, went through a whole sort of filtering process about how we might use different rooms. And to a large degree, this was about helping them think through how they wanted to teach. This was a change for them. So, you know, often when we're in these projects, we talk about the fact that we might be designing furniture or interiors or technology, but actually it's a change management project in essence. And the design process, I always think, plays a really important part in that change and getting people to think through and understand how they want to do things. So for them, exploring these spaces led them to understand different ways in which they might run some of their classes. So we had thinking about, you know, kind of mixed use with still retaining some sort of traditional classroom setups. Going through that process led them to, right, yeah, no, we don't want to do that. We want to just, you know, completely go for the flexible furniture and the collaborative environment. And that led us to some interesting places in terms of thinking about how the different rooms would work, what you could do in some rooms and you couldn't do in other rooms just because of the space constraints, and the different kinds of classes and the different kind of ways you would do that. And also thinking about how we, in the collaboration with Frank, how we would do that in terms of the technology. What could we build in so that that was movable? What would be built it? What would be there that would be a little bit less flexible? So we'd have to continue to work around in however the room was going to be used. So that was a key aspect, particularly on that sort of flexibility and change aspect.
Yep. Yes. One thing I neglected to say at the beginning, one of the things about this building is there's three floors of training rooms. The ground floor, or the first floor, as our American friends would call it, is double height stuff room, big spaces where there's big virtual environments. There's a reconfigurable cave, which is a virtual environment with motorized video walls, and there's a hole cut in the concrete slab with this projecting up through the basement, and you stand in the display. I think it was one of the earlier slides. And then on the second floor, there's flat classrooms, a bit like this, very, very flat. So the idea was it should have, in theory, been quite easy to make the space more kind of generic and easy to move things around. But the third floor was tiered space. It's tiered, traditional tiered kind of classrooms. How do you make a tiered classroom with changeable furniture and all that kind of stuff and being able to move things around and make it more collaborative? And that was one of the interesting challenges to do that, because do you take a ball and chain to it and knock it flat and try and do it that way or whatever? It was very quite an interesting challenge which David took on. The tech part of it was relatively easy for us in a tiered space, but on the first floor where you've got double height ceilings where you're trying to capture audio from around all over the place and everything else, it was it's a little bit more challenging, more difficult. David.
Yep, and that, I suppose, just going back to that process, that was tremendously helpful to them in those tiered classrooms of going through that decision-making process of, do we want to make them collaborative? Do we want to make rather more major architectural changes to the building to help us with the flexibility? Or actually, are we happy just to keep them as tiered and we'll focus on the collaboration in these spaces? So that was quite an important journey for them to go through of thinking about. So that led us on to think about furniture and explore different concepts around how we could get groups working together, what kind of size of group, what's the kind of the dynamic in the group going to be, how would this furniture be used in different contexts, how might we sort of fold them up so that we can put them away, how can we clear space to be able to use the room in a different way, and importantly, how are we going to integrate different kinds of technology into there so that people can share content through the classrooms, through the lessons.
There's enough space also on the desk for a pizza box to go with all the other technology.
a key question. We also looked at the instructor. So as I said, you know, in the pictures Frank showed at the beginning, they have this huge, great big desk with a load of screens. If they're sitting down, no one in the classroom can see them. It had just become this place for lecturers who had who were quite happy lecturing, but maybe had less social skills to just go and hide away in the corner of the classroom, and they weren't delivering particularly engaging lessons. So there was quite a bit of thinking into how do we get them out from behind this desk? How do we get them into the middle of the room? How can we have a piece of furniture that we can move around much more flexibly, and put them sort of in the heart of the action? And then we wanted to make sure that we were creating the right environment. You know, going back to some of the to some of the Google stuff, to us this was about trying to provide the right sort of stage for the activities of learning to happen. It was all very well having great technology in there, but if the acoustics were wrong, the rooms were dingy, no one really wanted to be in the rooms, people were starting to fall asleep in the afternoon just because it was such an awful environment, we really wanted to try and turn that round, and got some really good buy-in from the client to help us do that. So the first thing that we wanted to do was actually to try and get some daylight into the room. Remarkably, for a building that had the potential for lots of natural light, all of these rooms, there was no light, no daylight in any of them. So we did a whole study to look, particularly obviously wanting to be cautious about with the environment in the Middle East and the strength of the sun, how we would do that. So we went through a whole study looking at movement of the sun around the building and how we might provide different interventions on different sides of the building, reflecting the different kind of light that you're going to get on different facades of the building through the day. So this is just one of the things where we're putting in much more sort of louvered glazing. On the north side, it was much more sort of, there was much more glazing, and on the south side, much more protection against the sun. Were you going to say something?
Well, I was just going to say, and obviously the impact of any technology, your screens and other things that are in that space.
Yep. So then we went on to follow that up with looking at an artificial lighting scheme that was completely designed around A, the different configurations of how the room might be used and the way in which the technology would be used in there. We wanted to make sure that the lighting scheme, not only did it give a sort of uplifting environment to be in, but that it didn't diminish any of the usability of the room and the user experience of people learning and trying to teach in those spaces. We also looked at the acoustics. This will be interesting to see how the contractors actually managed to fit this out, because I've got a feeling they might not quite handle the different finishes in surfaces that we've specified around the room. But we really wanted to understand and make sure that the room worked for how people were wanting to talk to groups and wanting to have individual work and so on. So thinking about different surfaces, how different surfaces would work, from lecturers in different positions of the room is reflected in some of the surfaces that we've put into there. And as I said earlier, we wanted just to try and lift the image of the building and give it a greater connection with the organisation that they're working for. So we did a bit of reflection on thinking about branding and the kind of materials we might want to use. As I said, the environment was incredibly bland and sort of magnolia. So there was it could have been anywhere in the world, to be honest. So we wanted to try and think about how we got them some sort of visual connection with where they were in the Middle East and some reference back to sort of local tradition. Which led us into a whole thinking about materials palettes and a whole series of thoughts about how we might introduce graphics into the environment. And that's not just inside the classroom, but that's throughout the building to try and give some greater connection. So in outcomes, Frank, you wrote this one.
Yeah, so, I mean, yeah, it's usual, my kind of argument. So, I mean, the reality is the client has a kind of, you got a set of requirements and an end goal, the vision, if you like. And one of the things I'm really keen to focus on is, with everything that the client wants, is actually the user experience. It's got to be a real positive user experience. There's no point in going to all this trouble designing something which, like they had before for a number of years, which was just clunky, difficult, horrible, nobody wanted to be there, people were skiving off classes and all kinds of things, because it was just an awful place to be. So it's got to be a positive user experience with everything we do. and that's my goal really for anything, any project that I do with a client. It's key and fundamental. And this is what I want to, it's got to be, the learning experience has got to be engaging and everything else, and which is what we try to do with the tech. Not just tech for tech's sake. Try and take the technology out of the equation so that you've just got this nice, easy to use rooms. Put it all back a house. People don't care. They're not interested in what size workstation they got under the desk and all the other stuff. They couldn't care two hoots. So it's all about making the user experience the important thing.
So we've got a couple of images just... these are two, they might not be the first choice images, but these are the two that where we've stripped out all the client branding. So these are the two we can use. So you start to get a sense of how this is one of the flat classrooms, obviously, how it is very different from, visually in terms of, if you remember back to the images Frank showed at the start of the existing environment, but B, how far we've moved away from a sort of traditional classroom environment and created something where groups can come together in a very different way. And as I said earlier, all of this is flexible. You can demount it, move the desks around, and reconfigure things as they need to. And the infrastructure in the room supports that. So this is one of the flat classrooms, and then this is one of the sort of auditorium down on the third floor. This is the big auditorium. So the third floor has a series of smaller tiered rooms and then two big auditorium rooms like this. And this is used in a similar way to, Gary was talking about some of the bigger rooms probably for Google in terms of external stuff, but the experience in here was awful if you were sitting in the audience. You had lighting up in the ceiling that just shone in your face because of some desire, a bit like we are here, to light faces in terms of video conferencing of those rooms. So it was an awful experience to sit in the up in the seats up there, and it was cramped and so on. So we've changed the environment in these kind of spaces as well. Just to finish up, just a sort of few key things that we discovered and in working with Frank and some things on these projects.
Don't share those ones.
Yeah, okay. I'll keep those. Yes, to myself. Yeah. One of the interesting challenges, certainly for us, and I think for Frank as well, was this sort of iterative design process. Exacerbated slightly by we're in London, Frank's wherever he was, and his colleague Lee is in Norway, and the client's obviously in the Middle East. So how we did that virtually, and to keep pace with where we were each thinking at any point in our design process, was a challenge to keep on track, and we managed it. We managed to have some sort of virtual ways in which we could share ideas and keep ideas so that we all knew where we were in our thinking about some of the things and could bounce ideas off each other and could respond to some of the thinking. We found it really interesting because from our side, in terms of thinking about the requirement, our general desire is to stay away from design as long as possible. We want to invest as much time as we can in trying to understand what people are doing. We want to understand how the students are learning, how the teachers want to instruct people, and therefore we're always trying to abstract it and not really design anything. And that was kind of interesting when we're trying to work alongside a technologist like Frank, who, I guess, like many of you, to us seems to articulate your ideas in products. You could do something like this, you could do something like that, and that's just the way the conversation goes. And yet we're trying to always stay away from that, and it was quite a long time before we showed anyone what a piece of furniture might look like. So that was certainly for us that was a challenge.
It's probably why I ended up presenting for 6 hours, where you only ended up talking for half an hour.
That probably is part of it. The other thing was about how we looked at the analog solution. Certainly on the client side, through the earlier processes, there were a lot of technology people on the client side. So they really were interested in spending time with Frank, exploring all the what could we possibly do. So we had the conversations about whiteboards and digital whiteboards, and we could do this and we could do that. And we found it quite hard to kind of walk them back from that to say, if we want this learning experience to be really plug and play, we walk in, we don't want to get in the way of the lesson, what's wrong with a whiteboard? Why do we have to have something that is a technology solution that we know these lecturers aren't going to be able to turn on, you're going to be supporting it endlessly, it's not going to work, and therefore people are going to give up and not use it, you're going to waste a load of money. And in the end, we got them there. We got them with, I think, a really good balance of technology and analog solutions. So all of the rooms are plastered with whiteboards. Very simple for people to use. And that was part of that sort of debate. The implementation, so going through the sort of design process and implementation, as Frank alluded to earlier, we had a separation within the client team around technology and the built environment as the project went on. So whilst we needed to stay together, the client was increasingly diverging as we got through the design process. And that made it hard, so we had quite a lot of work to try and bring them back together, to try and get them in the same room, understanding things together. And as part of that, it meant that we, certainly from our side in terms of the interior design, meant that we went a long way through the project without really having anyone on the client side who understood how to build anything. They all understood the technology, could have great six-hour-long conversations with Frank. Ours was a half-an-hour conversation because none of them really understood the implications of how we might build this, how we might do a fit-out of these rooms, and what really were the implications of, you know, should we have false floors or not false floors, which seemed a ridiculous argument, but we went round and round it because so many people in our client team didn't really understand the sort of triviality of the question.
I think there's another dynamic that happened for us, which was that we started this project right at the start of when the oil price took a nosedive. And so the client was instantly become very conscious of cost. They also had a very large expat community of very expensive Americans and Brits working for them, and Greeks actually, kind of think of it. But as we went through the project, trying to kind of keep continuity with it all was quite challenging because you'd be working with somebody, and the next thing you know, they said, "Oh, I'm taking retirement." So they were leaving. So they would go, and then somebody else would come back in again, and then you got all this catch up, and so on and so on. And it was either to do with facilities or it was to do with the technology, as well as people dipping in and out from external sources. So it was really quite difficult. And add to that, obviously, as Gary can probably vouch for, is when you're doing with the different cultures and everything else. And you've got the cultural aspect of it, plus the process of the company and the business culture, which was quite challenging. So to try and keep all this on track with the interior part of it, with the technology bit, was seriously challenging. I have to say, really difficult.
And then one last point, I suppose, more from our side in the way we tend to work. So we like doing projects where we almost regard ourselves on the design team as the sort of voice of the user. We want to represent the views of the people who are the lecturers in this case or the students. To some degree, I don't really want to talk to management. I know I do really, but I, you know, in terms of the design process, I want their engagement. And we had some really good engagement and involvement with the lecturers and talking to students during the early design process. And if there's one thing I would probably have changed, it would have been to try and keep that consistent through the project. We do try and do that in terms of having sort of user groups and so on most of our projects, and that's probably, although I don't necessarily think in this case it's to the detriment of the project, but I think if there's one thing we could have done better, yeah, I would have liked to have had lecturers and other kind of end users engaged more through the process throughout to be able to voice how they wanted to use these rooms and how they could influence some of the design decisions.
But they seemed to come and go as well, so that was another problem.
Yep, absolutely. And then,
so the final key lesson, which I thought was quite amusing, was when I was working out there, thinking, remember a heart attack keeps you from being dead. So obviously a very key lesson, I suppose. That's quite a fundamental lesson to learn while you're out there. Well, anywhere, come to think of it.
Thank you.
Thank you.